I'd like that.
Yeah, that's a good thought.
Oh, that?
Yeah.
All right, good evening, everyone, and good evening, residents of Litchfield, and welcome to the February 22nd, 2017 school board meeting. I'd like to start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do we have any revisions?
I do not, Mr. Chair.
Excellent. Summary of non-public actions from February 8th, 2017. No non-public session was held. Presentations and recognitions. We have with us this evening our current two recipients of Empowering Excellence in Education Awards. The two recipients we have with us this evening is Christine Rooney, in recognition of Champion for Health and Wellness. And our second recipient, Steve Frazier, for Support and Leadership. And I'd like to say congratulations to both of you. What I'd like to do is turn it over to Mr. Lecliner, if you'd like.
Sure. So thank you. Thank you for taking the time to recognize two very distinguished professionals. I'll start with Chris. First of all, thank you and congratulations to both of you. So Chris came to us about 10 years ago, Chris?
Eight years ago.
And actually came from the Jaffrey district. She is the health teacher at the middle school. And she had the small charge of starting a new health program at the middle school. And I remember when I interviewed Chris, I asked her about, you know, teaching health, and she had taught in Jaffrey, and she said, yeah, I've written a health curriculum before. She had actually started the program out there. So she brought a lot of experience. She really is a very wise educator, has tremendous life experience, is a veteran. I think some of you know that. Was of high rank, can't remember exactly, in the Army, and so has a lot of neat experiences in life. Brings that into her classroom and just really brings the lessons to life for kids. Health at a middle school is a challenging area. My walkthroughs are sometimes interesting, what I walk into in a health classroom, but she is a professional and does a great job. Chris also is a champion, as you can imagine, for wellness and health, not only for students, but also for our staff. And we've had a need recently, over the last month and a half, couple of months, to bring our school up to speed on CPR training, first aid training, and Chris jumped right in on that. Actually, she was ahead of the curve before I even asked her. She had mentioned it several times. And most recently trained over 20 of our staff members. We have, so those are the people that weren't trained, and we already had 15 or so trained. So now we have a really good number of our staff trained. CPR is a very important certification for our staff to have. She continues to be very invested in moving that training forward over coming months. So I want to recognize Chris for that piece, but also for the things she does on a regular basis for kids, for health and wellness. And I think we all agree that a student who is not healthy or well is not going to be in a great capacity to learn. So I see students that she prepares very well, not just in health class, but also for their other classes, and they become very confident students as a result of her interactions with them. So congratulations, Chris. Steve Frazier is newer to us. He's been in the district for this year, third year. Steve is very passionate about a number of things. Mostly technology is an area that he is a real expert in. He came in when we transitioned to our literacy with technology. If you've been involved for a while, you're probably familiar with that course. It's an eighth grade course where students are interacting with literacy, but also in a computer lab where they're doing a lot of research-based, performance-based type of assessments and learning. And it really, to really get a flavor for Steve in his classroom, you really have to see it, you really have to be in there. Steve is more of a facilitator and a coach. When he's running his class, the kids are busy, the kids are engaged, the kids are learning, and he is really a champion for his students. In addition to the work he does in the classroom with technology, he also is extremely talented at training people. He's very patient. You know, as you can imagine, we have all ranges of experience with technology in our building, and Steve is always willing to jump in and train staff. We most recently had a group of classroom training. Ms. Garrett, a teacher who Steve teaches with, and Steve did a nice presentation. And it, as is the case with his students, he was a coach and a facilitator, and the teachers got a lot out of it because Steve was able to really set it up in a way that they're really engaged and really using the technology. So wanted to recognize Steve for a few things, but that technology piece definitely is a big part of who he is and what he does. Also this fall, if you're familiar with our drama club at the middle school, we've had a very popular club over the years. We had an advisor who got a teacher certification, and he moved on over the summer, which was good for him, bad for us. And that put us in a scenario where we were looking for a drama club advisor. It is a big job. The expectations are high. The students are very excited about what they're doing. And so we had to fill that vacancy. Steve, after several weeks of kind of not sure where we were going to go with drama club, Steve jumped in. He said, I don't have a lot of experience with drama, but he does work in a middle school. So
it's always drama.
But he jumped in, and if you came to our performance a few weeks ago, the kids did a great job. They've already started on their next performance. But I just want to recognize Steve's willingness to take on a risk and do something that he didn't have a huge depth of experience in, but has done a ton of work to get up to speed and done a really good job with those kids, with the program, and really bringing the community. There's a lot of volunteers that help out with Drama Club as well. So congratulations, Steve. Thank you. Thank you for your passion and your work.
Yes, congratulations to both of you. Again, I think it's wonderful that we're publicly recognizing certain individuals for excellence in their work and what they do. And it's greatly appreciated. Thank you. I'd like to do is give you your awards.
You want to take some pictures?
Oh, yeah.
Did you get the picture I sent you?
I did.
Okay.
We got all kinds of cameras today.
You want them up?
Can't avoid them.
Let me know when you're ready.
Huh? Yeah.
Why it passed.
It's on the phone. Do you want to get in and tell me while you're going to? Here, I'll go this way.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Tom, you're in.
I'll show it this way.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you.
Congratulations, Chris.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I got a long ride home.
Thank you. Congratulations to both you folks.
You.
It's great to be in our district. Thank you very much for all your hard work.
That'll bring us to correspondence. I don't think we had any, right? All right, that'll bring us to community forum.
Zoe.
You want to talk, Zoe? Superintendent comments.
Thank you. I would just like to bring up one thing. A number of years ago, we used to have an explanation of the warrant articles that went out to like the Hudson Litchfield News, what I understand, and get posted on the website. So we've made an attempt to put together some, you know, simpler explanations of what's in the warrant article. And what we're looking for is some feedback from you folks to let us know whether or not you think what we wrote makes sense, or whether it should be modified, or does it really, you know, cut to the chase, so to speak, in terms of what's going on. So we will get this the warrant article explanations and have those out to the local press and to the website, and certainly anybody who would like to put those up in other locations, I think it would be a good thing. There was also a question that came up today regarding the actual ballot, And I just want, I think we have to clarify for people that the, what you have is like the candidates for the school board, and underneath it says write-in candidate. So you have, for instance, Paula's name, underneath that says write-in. And then you have John's name, underneath it says write-in. I think people have to be clear that if they want to write someone's name, and it's got to be underneath the name up front, so that people just don't go to that very first block where it says write-in, and write it in that very first block. So I think we have to make an effort to clarify that to folks, that you have Paula, and then if you want to write in a candidate for that position, that three-year position, you write it in there. You have John, and if you want to write in a candidate for the one-year position, you write it in under John's name. And we can just try to get that clarification out there a little bit cleaner for people, too. So that was the other thing that came up today. Other than that, we're on vacation next week. We're all looking forward to getting out in this beautiful weather. And we have one person out there who's all in favor of vacation in the audience. And he's given it, we should have a two-week vacation now, not a one-week vacation. Is that correct? Or no, I won't ask you to give any feedback. Okay. But anyway, we have vacation next week, and everybody's looking forward to it. And, you know, I think it's a good time to be able to kind of recharge the batteries and things like that. Mm-hmm. Lots going on inside the district. We have a lot of meetings planned during the vacation, a lot of work with, obviously, we're coming up to the vote, and we've got to make sure that we continue to focus on that. And we also have a lot of other things coming on with budgets and everything else. So it's very busy, even though other people are on vacation. So that's about all I have to say, Mr. Chair.
Do we want to go through each warrant?
If you'd like to do that right now, we certainly can. And
may as well.
Take some notes. We won't. Michelle will.
Okay. So the first one is the Article 1 explanation. I'll just read it. This represents the proposed operating food service grants, food budget as recommended by the Budget Committee, and the default budget recommended by the School Board and reviewed by the Budget Committee. The increase of the fiscal year 18 operating budget over fiscal year 17 operating budget is due to cost increases in New Hampshire retirement, rate increases, health insurance rate increases, special education required support services, transportation contract increases, and technology purchases. Detailed information on the proposed operating budget and default budget can be found at, that shows the website. Does anyone have anything on that or thoughts? If I'm not mistaken, the increases just in those categories exceeds what the increase in the budget is it not?
I believe that's correct, Mr. Chair.
I'm just wondering if the operating budget is due to, well, it's all due to, I guess. I'm just wondering if we can make it more pronounced that just those items alone exceed the increase in the budget from one year to the next, or if it's necessary.
Yep. We'll certainly draft some language along that line. Run it by you folks and see if you like it.
Yeah.
Where does this get posted, or where is this going to be printed?
Well, I think historically it used to go into the Hudson Litchfield News.
Okay.
And then I was thinking that we would probably put it on our website, put mm-hmm. it on Superintendent's blog, mm-hmm. and then certainly we could try to get it out into the community in different formats. Mm-hmm. We certainly, Facebook, if people want to put something out there, just okay. direct people to this.
Yep.
We're not, you know, you still have to have the playing ballot, so to speak, for the actual voting.
Right.
So this all has to occur ahead of time. We could also put some of these, if we're allowed to, I'm not sure we'll be allowed to, where the vote is taking place. So if people want to kind of have a reading there, they could read this yeah. before they vote. Yeah, but I'm not sure they're going to be allowed to do that or not.
Yeah.
I was planning on posting a rundown of each article on my Facebook page and Litchfield School Board
yep.
page.
Yeah.
On Facebook.
Right. The next article is Article 2. Which is the school district collective bargaining with the LEA. Article explanation, the proposed two-year teacher contract has been ratified by both the Litchfield School District and the Litchfield Education Association. The Budget Committee supports this article. Year one contains a salary schedule modification that removes step one, adds a top step, and increases each step 1.5. Teachers remain on their current step and will have an increase in co-pays for prescriptions, doctors, urgent care, ER visits. Year two contains a 2% increase to each step, and teacher move up one step. Teacher pay an additional 1% in health care premiums. In year one, there will be projected health care insurance savings of $45,000. In year two, a projected health insurance savings of $19,500. It should be noted that in approving this article, voters are approving the contract and cost items included in the contract. Failure of this article means teachers will have no contract and the district will have to go back into negotiations next year. The only thing I'll say is, someone who doesn't know the step process and everything else, I think will be like, what are you saying?
Steps are confusing, yeah.
The only other suggestion I have would be to put year one projected health insurance, like keep year one stuff with year one, just to clean it up as far as readability.
Yeah.
And maybe in year two, when you're talking about the projected health insurance, that's a saving of $19,000 over the $45,000, correct?
Yes, I was gonna say maybe indicate that's annual, provide that's an annual going forward. It's not like a one-time savings.
Right.
Okay.
So I don't know if you just want to say like what the percentage of increase would be for the teacher or just, I mean, obviously leave it as that, but it just, I think someone who doesn't understand the whole step process may just be like really confused, say, so what are they getting?
Yep. The slide deck I used for deliberative that explains the step process is also like online and posted on our school board page, so not that that helps here, but it is out there.
Right.
That's right.
You could post a link to that, right?
You could.
So I'm just thinking that we can just clean up as far as, I'm not sure how you want to.
Yeah, I think we have, let me find, I have the numbers. Where's my slide deck?
Where are you planning to?
It has to be in, submitted to the HLN Tuesday.
Okay.
This next Tuesday? When, voting is the?
14th.
The 14th.
Tuesday, all right.
Yeah, I ran this by Holly's, you know, so I had it right.
Yeah.
But I can definitely clarify that it's a salary schedule. You know, move up a step in the salary schedule so they'll understand that it's like a ladder effect.
Yeah, I think just by putting that in there would probably be helpful.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I can, I'm happy to take a stab at kind of what I was going to write anyway and sharing that with you.
Okay.
We can.
Brings us to Article Three, which is the collective bargaining between the Litchfield School District Support Association. The proposed two-year contract has been ratified by both the Litchfield School District and Litchfield Support Staff Association. The Budget Committee supports this article. Year one, support staff will move one step plus 0.4% on the schedule. Support staff will have an increase in co-pays for doctor visits. Year two contains no step movement, but will receive an increase of 2.7% on the schedule. Employee insurance premium contributions will increase 1% in year one and 1.5% in year two. The contract includes $200 for workshops or course reimbursement for employees. It should be noted that approving this article, voters are approving the contract and cost items included in the contract. Failure of this article means support staff will not have a contract and the district will have to go back to negotiations next year. I think the same thing in here too. In the teacher one, you put down what the savings was in insurance, but not in this one, because there is a savings for both the change in insurance and the percentages, and also the change of copay, which is a savings to the community. Anyone else have anything on this one? Article Four, appropriation of $92,000 for a full-time special service coordinator. And the explanation is, this is a significant number of, there is a significant number of identified students with special needs in the district. This position would be certified special education administrator. It will provide coordination of compliance, provide representation at meetings, coordinate staff, handle issues that may occur, and assist the special service director and department. And I don't know if we want to put in there, because I mean, it's been part of what we talked about, where this position is going to be helpful, how it's going to alleviate a lot of, I don't want to say pressure, but it's going to give the principals time to do what
their
they
job.
Should be doing, their job, yeah. You know, just adding some, because I mean, that's, we talked about it. I mean, the principals right now and the assistant principals spend a lot of time doing the work what this person would be doing, and then allow them to do other administrative work and maybe coaching and developing of the teachers.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Article Five, shall Litchfield School District vote to raise appropriate the sum of $61,645 to purchase security equipment and to enhance the safety of the buildings. The explanation, Department of Homeland Security completed an assessment of the school district's buildings and provided recommendations to enhance safety and security for the school buildings. Security priorities addressed in the article are additional cameras for the main entrance of GMS, LMS, and CHS, ballistic film for glass for detriment of intrusion, fencing around the portables at GMS and LMS. Were those the priorities, or were there other priorities, but these are...
Those are the ones you mentioned at deliberative.
Those are...
I know they are, but I also mentioned that they weren't necessarily the most expensive ones, or most expensive...
Right, right.
They were also the ones that we could do immediately, as opposed to waiting for the capital improvement plan to see exactly how do we address the more costly expenses that would also provide...
Maximum benefit.
That maximum benefit in terms of time it takes for anybody to get into your buildings.
And for the capital, too, for $60,000, I mean, it's going to give you some decent protection.
If you take a look at what you have now versus what you'll have after that money, there'll be some significant protection for the buildings, absolutely.
You know, while we're on that, before I forget it, especially the portables, we talked about the portables. The other day when I walked past them, just an FYI, that the snowbanks, we talked about the portables and, you know, accessibility and that, the snowbanks were blocking the portables. That pile of snow in front of it, you couldn't even see this, you didn't know the portable was there. And I think for security reasons, maybe they put the snow somewhere else.
Is GMS or LMS?
GMS. The pile's come down quite a bit in the last couple of days, but it was quite the pile of snow in front of it.
Okay. You got that right?
Got it.
Thank you.
Like I said, it's kind
of... Take care of it Friday.
Tomorrow. From else.
Yeah.
Like I said, think for the most part. I think this is like right after the last storm. I just like realized, like, wow, this is like, it's huge.
Yeah, I didn't even notice it, but thank you for bringing that. Yeah, we'll take care of it tomorrow.
Mother will take care of that.
The next is Article 6, shall Litchfield School District vote to raise the appropriate up to $100,000 to be added to the Special Education Capital Reserve. The explanation, costs related to special education are often unanticipated. The district is aware of additional incoming special education student placements that are not included in the proposed budget. The placements can run in excess of $100,000 per student. Additional monies for this reserve fund are necessary for support of placement when they occur.
Are we aware of additional placements coming in?
We have one that just came in.
Right, but that...
Well, we had talked about the fact that we had one student that just came in this year, mm-hmm. and that there were three other students that we were reviewing, and most recently my statement was that the number two student we feel may be placed next year and perhaps this year. The number three student we feel the trend line on that student isn't good. That could be a replacement, but the number four student looks like it's not going to have to be a placement for the district. So where we asked Devin to really have a very tight budget this year, normally in my history as being a superintendent, we would build in one or two placements into the budget, and this year we haven't done that. So we're looking to have that extra money so that we could so that we could place a child should that child need placement. If the money is not needed, the money stays in the account. It's not expended by the district. It can't be expended for anything else except for those things that would be approved by the school board, which would specifically be emergency situations for special education.
And there's also been a lot of talk about, well, kids get identified and kids come off IEPs and such and things like that, and for those kids who are able to come off an IEP, that's not the cost impact that you're looking at. You're looking at a child who will not, when you're talking about this kind of cost impact, you know, the on and off, that's something that you can manage throughout the year.
Right.
You're not, that doesn't have anything to do with this.
No.
This is a child who won't.
And we looked at those.
That's the difference.
Absolutely. And we looked at what we currently have in district that would be aging out of IEPs because of the law,
mm-hmm.
and we currently don't anticipate anybody aging out next year.
Mm-hmm.
Article 7, shall Litchfield School District vote to raise and appropriate up to $50,000 to be added to the Building Maintenance Capital Reserve Fund. Current balance at this time is $101,007.69. Article explanation, facility systems and equipment failure are often unanticipated. Facility systems in the school buildings are maintained, but some are very old and can fail at any time. The reserve fund was established to address critical failure of building systems and equipment and the related costs that are not included in the proposed operating budget. So I think that's pretty self-explanatory. I think, if I'm not mistaken, I just read that in Hudson, they're replacing the roof on the library, is it?
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember what the dollar amount was that they talked about. I know it was in the hundreds of thousands of dollars.
$175,000.
They basically were taking it from their fund that, it was quite a large fund that they were extracting it from. And when you consider the cost of a roof, I think would exceed $101,000.
Absolutely.
And then Article 8, shall the Litchfield School District vote to raise the appropriate $25,000 to be added to the Technology Capital Reserve established in 2016? And the explanation is major failure of technology systems are unanticipated and can occur at any time. The reserve fund is necessary to address those failures and issues when they occur for related costs that are not included in the proposed support operating budget. Yeah. So I think just the two with the contracts, yep. And just, and anyone else has anything else, I think just cleaning up the contracts, yeah. and pay.
And to be clear, with these, the warrant articles that have no,
tax,
you know,
impact.
No tax impact, if they fail, that money that's left over doesn't necessarily, correct, go back to the taxpayer, because some of that money could be encumbered by the school board,
mm-hmm.
for other reasons.
Correct.
That's correct.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure that.
But if these fail, then it couldn't be used for.
It couldn't be used for that.
Correct.
But it could be used for other unanticipated things that could,
yep.
happen. I just don't want the public to think that if they don't vote for these, that the money is automatically, or, and you know, there seems to be word out there that it automatically will go back, and that there could be other things that could happen as well.
Correct. Because the monies that would be used are monies that have already been voted by
the
public, the taxpayers,
right.
for the school to use. Correct.
I do have a question for the board.
Yep.
On the three capital reserve articles, do you want me to leave the balance of what's in the fund, that wording in there, or do you want me to take it out?
I would leave it in.
It's up to you.
Well, wait a minute. The balance, you mean the balance of the fund as of?
Yeah, like the last one was like 101,000.
That's on the ballot anyway, right? But that's not the balance.
It doesn't have to be on the
ballot.
I didn't know if, I just wanted to give you that option if the board wanted it.
Well, I think the fact that they all state that, you know, like when they were established, like looking at Article 6 was established in 2004 and showing that, you know, in 2004, you had, since then, you only have $104,000 in there.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see any harm. I mean, they're.
I think it's transparent. I think,
yeah,
it's good to have.
I mean, all of them have been established and they've all been set up. So, mm-hmm. you know, just, you can show them, here's what's in there.
Mm-hmm.
Especially the building maintenance. You only have $100,000 in, you know, building maintenance.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's really not much as far as an insurance policy.
Mm-hmm. So we'll try to reword these and get those back out for you to take a look at. If you have some other thoughts, just please email Michelle and I so that we can follow up on it.
Yep.
And before we put them in the press, we'll make sure everybody's had a chance to look at it.
Yep. That will bring us to school board comments. Shaking head, nope. I actually just had a couple of things that, and I'll reiterate what I said last week or 2 weeks ago, and that is, as far as the graduation date, that I know that a lot of people would like to get it as soon as possible, and I, if I'm not mistaken, since our last meeting when I said that the date is still fluid, we had 3 snow days.
Yeah.
So, and it just goes to show you how quickly in New England and that things can change. If I'm not mistaken, I believe that as it stands right now, that if we had no more snow days, would it be on the 16th? I know it's still kind of fluid, but I mean, just.
The way the law reads is you have to go 5 days less than the other students. However, you can also go to hours that you've had, and if you meet the state requirement for hours, then you're allowed to have your graduation as long as you've met the state requirement for hours.
Right.
Now, we did this analysis last year, and we came up with the fact that we had a significant number of hours over what was required by the state, so that we could back up the graduation date, so it was more than 5 days before the actual end of the school year for the rest of the students. So at this point in time, I would say that, you know, we're still in a fluid position.
Right.
And I wouldn't want to make any promises.
So no,
it could be the 16th.
Right.
I mean, could even be potentially, I don't think it would be later than the 16th. Let me put it that way. I mean, there is a potential, if we do the hours analysis, we might be a little squeeze enough hours out to do a little bit earlier than that. But the 16th, I think, would be the latest it would be.
And I believe the way the calendar is written right now is last day of school, I think, is the 20th, but that's with 4 snow days. So if that were the case,
22nd.
Then
Yeah.
Now we're on the
22nd. Now the 22nd.
School. Yes, right.
So the 22nd would still allow the 16th to occur.
That's correct.
As of today.
That's correct.
And then we could always just cancel April vacation and go to school on Saturdays.
We could.
I won't be here.
I mean, you won't.
There are some.
I'm just saying, there are other things that can be done. And I guess I'm just saying, because I know that a lot of people are really, you know, trying to like get plans
sure.
set, and we would love
Absolutely.
to be able to give you a concrete date, but unfortunately, just right now, it's mm-hmm. it's still like I said, a fluid proposal. The other thing I wanted to mention, because a couple of people have brought to my attention, or just mentioned in passing, Blizzard bags.
Mm.
we've had a lot of conversation about this, but. I think one of the things we should look at in this year coming, and I know we talked about before, you know, once everyone gets on like a one-to-one, like in high school, it'll be a lot easier sending out programs, but I would think that even without everyone being on one-to-one, we can do something through online that every teacher, if there were a snow day type thing coming up, that they could put something out there to their students. And I just think, you know, we should have, because this is like 3 years in a row that we're on the edge as far as when's graduation, when isn't graduation, what's going on. Then maybe we can have some conversation like, what can we do?
Go to hours.
Mm-hmm.
Go to an hour schedule versus this yeah. days thing and get it all in there. Look at the Manchester model and have a beginning and end day and be done with it. I don't want my kids doing work on snow. I just, you know, I don't know. I don't like blizzard bags. I don't like that, you know, school.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's this stress factor of after school that's really affecting kids, and it's starting to come out now, and all data and everything, and mm-hmm. it's not the way to go.
We certainly can, you know, look back into those options that we have. I mean, I was pretty clear in where I sat last year. We certainly can revisit that. Some of the challenges.
Well, I don't think it's going to go anywhere. Revisit anyway. I'm not saying blizzard bags. I'm just saying.
No,
I mean,
I know.
The alternatives.
Yeah. But I think that, you know, using technology to deliver, you know, instruction at home when kids aren't here is something we should be doing anyway. So we can certainly look into that and see at what point in time could we transition to, you know, instruction being delivered at home in case we don't have school. I think that's a good direction to be going in, so that we could have not blizzard bags, but technology bags, if you would, or whatever, and have those available for kids at home. Certainly we can look into that. I'll just leave it at that.
Yep. Anyone else have anything? All right. Next we have draft minutes from 1/25/17. These we didn't vote on our last meeting because we did not have a quorum at that time.
Sorry.
Well, Paul and I did a good job by ourselves.
We were out very quickly, just so you know. Do you need a motion to accept these minutes?
Yes.
Okay, I'll make a motion to accept. Second. Draft minutes.
Second. I second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstain. We have the draft minutes from February 8th, 2017, non-meeting.
Okay.
We don't really have to approve those because you didn't have a quorum.
Okay.
So I just transcribed them anyway, just to be transparent.
Frank just walked out of the room, and we have budget transfers to approve from January 2017.
And November 2016, didn't end up, I found out you didn't end up approving though.
You have a pretty comprehensive list of those, so.
Yep. Is there a motion to accept the transfers?
Second.
So all those in favor of accepting the budget transfers to January 2017, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain. Now we have budget transfers for November of 2016. Is there a motion to accept the transfers from November 2016?
So made.
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the budget transfers for November 2016, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain. That will bring us to the business administrator's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I did file the report with you last week, and if you have any questions on the financial side, I did want to point out in the financial report, I did a summary, if you will, of, it's called 2017 operating budget. I wanted to give the board some idea of what actually encompasses the budget outside of salary and benefits. And as you can see by the report, the total operating budget are those funds that are available to run the school district outside of salaries and benefits totals approximately $4.5 million, which represents 22%, and that's consistent with our 78%, which goes to salaries and benefits. But I wanted to provide the list because it's very difficult, if you were to go through the operating budget, to make a determination what is actually required as an operating expense or what might be discretionary. And what it really comes down to is of that 4.5, the only real discretionary monies that we have in there, and one could argue whether or not it is, would be supply. The monies that go towards supplies for classrooms, because everything else on this list, and you can see, you know, audit services, professional services, repair and maintenance to the buildings, inspections, oil, propane, those are not discretionary. We must have those. So when you really look at a $21, $22 million operating budget of the Litchfield School District, you can probably say that, I would say, less than $1 million of it is truly discretionary. To the extent. So I did want to provide that to the board to kind of give a quick overview, a snapshot, if you will, of just what money outside of the salaries and benefits do we have control of, and just how much money is there in each of those lines. So I'm hoping you find that is helpful. We did have in the report as well the transfers for the month of January. And just a quick note on transportation. Michelle just did receive updated ridership calculation, the numbers, if you will. I believe we have resolved the issue. We had a couple of late bus issues going on at LMS.
That's not resolved.
And that's been resolved.
No.
No?
My daughter still hasn't made it to school on time.
Okay. So got that information coming out of LMS then. So we may need to make some changes there. To resolve that. So
we have another bus breakdown yesterday.
Mm-hmm. I wasn't notified of it. If we did. Typically, the notification will go
according to the Litchfield moms. Yes.
I saw one parked on the street with a tow truck behind it. So yeah.
That's probably a good indication.
No, that was just.
I mean, they're probably getting to the school before the bell rings, but
again,
they're walking in the door as like announcements are going off, which doesn't give you time to actually go to your locker, get your stuff, drop your stuff off.
So we will have a conversation with the school administrators. There are a couple of things that we can change with regards to stops. Have to remove some stops from those two buses. I think it's 4 and 7.
Do you know if that's a bus that comes to the high school first?
I don't know.
It's bus 7.
Bus 7, yes.
Bus 7 starts. Bus 7 is a huge route, and I believe it starts with.
It starts in like Tanager and goes to my house, which is like by.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Like the golf course. Like.
So we'd have to take a look at that.
I thought it gets picked up at like 7:27. There's no way she can make it from our house plus three or four more stops by 7:34.
Yeah.
There's no way. It's just not possible.
So So we'll have to, we'll get back to.
In fairness, the schedule says 7:20. It's just they've never made it.
Right.
Not even close.
It's too, the run is just too long.
Well, and that's why I asked if it came from the high school or not. I mean, if it comes from the high school, then maybe it's looking at the high school.
No, that one, 7, I believe, starts right with LMS. I'd have to double check, but I'd have to look at the rules.
Frank, on the transportation note, have we looked into, I know at one point you had mentioned there was an app for that. When buses are late in the morning, when buses are late leaving school, and generally in the afternoon, a Blackboard message goes out from the principal saying, you know, bus such and such is going to be 10 minutes late or whatever. But there isn't anything, there's no communication to parents or students in the morning if they're outside waiting for a bus that has broken down or something like that. Is there a way to, are we looking at implementing some kind of a system so that kids aren't waiting out for half an hour in the cold?
We don't.
We don't have anything like
no,
that.
No, I believe. Procedurally, the bus company is to notify the individual principal, the administration, so that they know, regarding the bus being late.
Okay.
Now, it's something I'm sure through the superintendent we could ask that when they do get that notification, we send out an email, but again, how many
are going to get it? Right.
No.
Okay.
Do we ever use Blackboard in the morning, Frank, to notify parents that
I believe we have, but I think it was specific to
trying to look at my trash because I thought I saw
on the accident, the one we had that accident
early in the morning. I can't remember which day it was this week to notify parents of a bus. Let me see if I can find.
And it might have been that I didn't get it because my child isn't on that bus.
I don't recall seeing anything.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I saw something. I know in the afternoon that's pretty routine, but yeah. I believe I saw something in the morning too. But we can certainly get a little bit more aggressive.
Even just
with
more
that.
Than one avenue, like
yeah.
Besides just an email, maybe a tweet, yeah. Like for those who follow one more
good.
Than the
yeah.
other. That you know what I mean? Just to have a couple avenues to look at
mm-hmm.
To be notified, because I know I'm more of a. I'd get a ping for a tweet, but I don't check my mm-hmm. email like that. You know
I see that a lot of posts by parents on the Facebook pages.
Blackboard, I believe, does have the ability to text as well.
Mm. Yeah.
But I have to double check that.
I mean, everybody usually has this on.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I can't confirm
but
that one way or the other.
We certainly could ask, and part of the problem is the communication from the bus company to administration that those buses are running late. Or I'm not sure if we had a formal discussion about it, but there is an app out there that actually can be, I think Londonderry has it,
mm-hmm.
that parents can download onto their smartphone, and it'll GPS actual location of the bus,
mm-hmm.
and if you have any
neat.
Notices. It's something that, we have some literature on it. We really haven't gone too far into it. But the buses that do run in our district have GPS, so it could be something that we can certainly take a look at for next school year. It's pretty slick. It'll give you notices, and it will tell you. Mm-hmm. You can set it if the bus is running 5 minutes late. You get a text, and I don't know if you've seen it.
I haven't seen it. That's great.
It's fairly new. It's been out a few years, but I know Londonderry has been utilizing it for a year now. So we can take a look at that too.
Great.
It's another mode of communication.
Isn't there a fee involved with that
yeah.
for the user?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's one the bus company should absorb.
Me too. I totally agree. That would be on the list of many, however.
Yep.
I can't find it, so maybe I saw something different.
All right. Does anyone have any other questions for Frank on the report? I know Mr. Pelletier is not here this evening. Are we going to talk about E-rates right now?
Yes. And I have just a few other things, if I may, Mr. Chair.
Yep.
Just a couple of quick snowplow I got on my list of things. Just a quick update. And a shout out actually to Eddie Dalton from Dalton Farms. We've had some difficult storms this winter. This is the third year of a 3-year contract with Dalton Farms. The first year, we had a great deal of difficulty with our plow contract. And it is nice to have someone who's local, mm-hmm. who I know the storms, because they've come in the morning. We've had staff here working, even though school was off. And, you know, Eddie, you call Eddie Dalton up, he'll come through and make sure everybody gets out, and tomorrow we'll
call him up, he'll have the front end loader.
Yeah, so just a shout out to Ed and his drivers. They've done a real good job for us this past winter. Building assessment, we're moving along. We now have pushed the date, however, to end of March for the first draft coming to the school board. They have fallen behind just a little bit in their schedule, so that they're asking if we can push it forward. And we said, no, when you get it, we'll deliver it to the board. So we're looking at a March, somewhere towards the end of March for that. The last item on buildings and grounds, we did put out, it's called a request for a quote. We have two openings in our grounds department, and as we get closer to the spring, if we do not have hired and trained staff to go out and start cutting fields and lining fields, we will be in trouble with the athletic directors at both LMS and CHS. So we have actually put out a request for quote for local landscapers to look at a bid package if anyone's interested. It is on the website. The bid package to give us a quote to cut and fertilize and maintain the grounds until we're able to hire the grounds folks and get them trained and get them running. So that is out there, and I believe that the date for submission is no later than March the 14th, I believe it is.
Is that a contract for the year?
Just until June 30th for this year.
Just until June 30th.
Through the spring, yep. And it has a 30-day out clause, so if we do have someone and have them trained up, we can give the company a 30-day notice that we're going to move it back in-house.
Yep.
The site says March 10th, Friday, March 10th.
March 10th, I'm sorry.
No later than 2 p.m.
Yep. It is on the website.
Mm-hmm.
Food service, if you you should have all received, I believe, as parents, students, and I believe it went out to faculty as well, a survey monkey for the food service program. I understand the results are coming in fast and furious on that, so that if you haven't already, it would be most appreciated if folks could get that into us so we can take the feedback and make some changes in the food service program. There's also, and we'll come with a more formal presentation to you, but part of every year we have to complete what is called a paid lunch equity calculation to make sure that what we're charging is equal to or greater than what we're being reimbursed, so that we're not supplanting our reimbursements on the free and reduced lunch program. And after going through that calculation, our weighted average for what we charge here in Litchfield, we have a 22-cent credit, meaning that we're still we're okay with our charge for our meals at all three locations. So unless otherwise needed, we will not be coming with a recommendation to make any changes to the meal prices at all three schools.
Okay.
That is it, sir.
Thank you. So, do you have an expected date for the building committee to get back together then?
I would say once we get the report to you folks and you have an opportunity to review it and ask any questions, and we would move the draft right to the committee as well. We up the committee, if you will, and have them take a look at the draft. I would like the school board and the committee both to look at the draft before we finalize it with H.L. Turner.
Are we talking like maybe April?
I would think first couple weeks in April. And I can certainly send out an email to everyone to give them an update for the community.
That'd probably be helpful because it's been quite a while since everyone got together.
Yeah, right.
Just let them know that, the process.
Yep.
I mean, they knew to begin with the process was going to take some time.
But just to remind
them. It's taking a little bit longer.
Yep, sure. I could do that. I'll send an email out to the committee tomorrow.
Yeah. You want to send it out? Do you want the president to send it out?
I'll send it out.
All right. So that'll bring us to E-rate, which utilizes it to.
Jason's absence, I've been asked to be to present. By way of background, again, E-rate money comes in as in the form of reimbursements for certain invoices, specifically in internet, Comcast, and those sorts of things that participate in the E-rate program. We do receive money as participating in that program. We put the money into, when it comes into us as a reimbursement through the E-rate program, we put it into deferred revenue, so it doesn't go into the revenue into the general fund. It's kind of a set aside, if you will, and we've got that. That's been that way for a good 7 or 8 years in the district. So we set that money aside. Right now we just received a check for approximately $16,000, which brings us up, I believe, to a balance of somewhere over $30,000. And we're anticipating another $30,000 to $40,000 will come in for this current school year. Jason's request, you've heard Jason before, we have connectivity issues going into the two portables at the two locations, GMS and LMS. He has a proposal from a company that will come in and actually erect telephone poles, for lack of a better phrase, and run lines that way from the pole into the portables. It would be too costly for us to trench out the old lines that are underground. So in Jason's proposal is to utilize E-rate funds, which is specific for the intent of E-rate, is to put the money back into the technologies, and this certainly would coincide with the goal of the E-rate funds.
So you're saying they have connectivity problems. They have an issues right now that...
That's my understanding. The coax goes on the underground, and it's eroded, and it's in bad shape, I guess, right now.
No, I realize it's in bad shape right now, but I mean, are they having problems as far as getting whatever they're going to get from this?
No. Well, part of this has to do with, is part of his upgrade for the bandwidth, and they cannot go underground because you just can't get right there from underground because of the way the coax is.
Well, I'm sure it's a lot less expensive than going underground.
Oh, it's much less expensive, yep. So the board would need to approve the use of the E-rate funds in the amount being requested.
What is the price difference out of curiosity, just because... It looks like crap, right?
The portables already do look
I know. I mean, so. Do you want to make it look worse?
Yeah.
I can hang Christmas lights from it afterwards.
I know Jason, you know, he's kind of been all over it, but I think it's part of trying to get under the portables. There's a cost factor. There's an accessibility issue there as well. And I know that he was pretty pleased the way the proposal came out as far as it wouldn't interfere with anything in the pole. You'll have a pole.
I think we also
a pole and
a wire coming across. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. I think we all hope that the portables disappear someday. So, I mean, if that's the case, the less money we spend on them, the better off we are.
Yeah. But, I mean, a pole has a cost, too. And, you know, it's not like you're building, you're not digging up a whole entire pavement. You're literally, like, slicing a line and digging in, dropping a culvert in or something. I have no idea how much it costs. I'm just curious.
Just kind of wish we knew how close are we to getting rid of those portables. You know, are we? Is this a?
I don't think we're that close.
No.
I would agree with that.
You need two rooms and a bathroom.
I know.
So.
I would agree with that.
Okay.
And we're talking about adding
GMS.
Yeah.
GMS. Yeah. And then LMS needs four rooms.
Yeah. Yeah.
And don't forget, we're looking at a second and third grade additional
right
teacher this year, GMS. And
so 2 years ago, it looked more promising, and now all of a sudden,
with your cohorts.
We gave away the rooms. I mean, now we have a music room and a computer room. So,
I think what we need to seriously talk about next year, though, is buying portables at LMS.
Oh, yeah. Because we own the ones at GMS.
Yes. But we're paying more in the lease for the ones at LMS than if we bought them.
Mm-hmm.
And we can buy brand new instead of like the dilapidated things that they are.
We're going to do an addition on it too.
Yep.
Yeah. Except the addition would be a lot more than portables.
It would be.
But it would also not be portable.
Yeah. People don't care. It would be safer.
Right.
You wouldn't have to go outside when it's raining else to go to the bathroom.
I would always be in favor of brick and mortar.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Well, it's definitely
right.
I mean, if we have an expanding population, I don't know if you would have any access to any of the, what do you call
impact
it?
Impact fees.
The funds.
The impact fees.
The impact fees.
Well, they're putting in, how many houses are they putting in down off page?
Like 20 or 30?
Yeah, like a lot.
Yeah.
Plus, well, I mean, down on for those, right? 3A right now, there's like two or three new ones.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if we'd have to draw a nexus between, you know, in needing the brick and mortar buildings and the expanding population of students coming into the district. But with the cohort this year being quite unexpectedly large in second and first grade, if we see that again, we might be able to draw that nexus, and you might be able to draw into some of that money.
That's a good idea. Can you look, can you connect the town and find out,
yep,
A, if we have a balance? I don't think we do anymore. I think we had a return to all.
There still
it
is.
It goes by schools.
Yeah.
In the location, I can get, yep, that.
And then how much we're going to be getting from the new developments?
Yep.
It's a good idea.
Yeah.
Could be a warrant article next year if we could offset it by, I don't know what the impact fees are, but if there's 40 houses going in, it's, mm-hmm, a couple $1,000 each, you know. Yeah.
It's going to get spread out over the three schools, too. Yeah.
And there is some support in Concord for fees, reimbursement for construction. I don't know how much, if it's going to pass, and if it does pass, I don't think it's going to be a large chunk of money. But certainly in the state, we need to start supporting our infrastructure, and part of the infrastructure is our public school buildings, yeah, mm-hmm, and providing money to allow us to build new public schools, because it's very difficult. We have some support and some reimbursement from the state.
You'd think it'd be pretty easy going to get rid of portables and build buildings, or an addition to the building. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah, when you're talking just security in itself, it's like well worth it.
I would agree with that. There's a whole bunch of reasons why. If it was attached to the building, your kids have better access to your libraries, better access to your PE, better access to OT, better access to PT. I mean, just, you can make the list go on and on. And security, obviously, is much better. So, I mean, there's many, many, many reasons why, from an educational perspective, having brick-and-mortar additions makes a heck of a lot more sense than portables.
Yeah.
And then the cost versus a new building. I'm sorry, but like adding another addition with, I'm sure, everything that's been slapped on down there, yep, I can't even imagine how many systems you're working with and how costly that is all the time.
Correct.
That's, it's crazy.
Is there a motion to utilize $9,942.50 at E-rate for technology department?
I think there is. Can we look into whether or not digging is appropriate, though, or I don't know. Like, the ones at GMS aren't going anywhere anytime soon. We own them. They're not going anywhere. Like,
right,
if digging is possible and it's not that much more money, I'd go that route, I guess. But yes, I'd make a motion to approve the funds.
But do you want to find what the quote is first, as far as to dig?
Sure. Do this soon, or when we guys plan on doing this?
I don't know.
Okay. I don't want to hold it up either. You know,
no, but I'm just wondering. I'm not saying put out the bid, but just getting like, can someone give us like a ballpark, like what it costs?
On the underground to
yeah,
remediate? Yeah, sure.
I mean, because you wouldn't have to get
Didn't
a bid for that, right?
Talk about that?
I think the cost estimate.
Already has,
I think already talked.
Probably the same company can give.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Give them a cost estimate to go.
I thought Jason had already talked about that.
There was a reason. It wasn't just the dollars.
There was a
there's
whole,
another
yeah,
structural reason why we cannot go underground.
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah, but I'm not sure what it is.
Maybe?
A water table or something, maybe?
I think he talked about it. He couldn't feed the wires through the channel they're in right now.
Yep. Right, so they'd have to trench out
a
new
ditch.
Right. So I don't know what would prohibit him from doing that. That piece
and of conduit.
You're just cutting the pavement, digging down 18 inches.
Not even that. Depending on how big of a piece of conduit you need. You know?
Yeah. It probably still 18 inches down, but it's still
I can have him get a cost.
But think of irrigation. You know, it's like,
it's easy.
Dig a line in, like, but it's going through pavement in LMS. Well, both schools, I think it's going through pavement. They have the repair.
We get your cost estimate of digging a new trench.
Yeah, if you just add it for the next meeting.
And
then
it's going under that road.
I mean, it should be simpler.
Yeah, almost
be
harder. And LMS.
So in the meantime.
Yeah, but LMS is going from.
Hopefully we have longer term solutions.
Right, LMS is going to go from the main building, so you're going to have to like trench across.
Yeah, that'd be harder.
The roadway and then trench it into the pavement.
And I don't know where the access points are either. So I think just
that can get pricey too, by the way.
Yeah.
Now you're looking at excavation, repacking.
Yeah. Maybe just give us an idea, like what the difference would be. I mean, if it's twice as much, then obviously it's more cost effective to do
this. We'll get that for you next meeting.
All right. Then we'll just vote on it then.
Yep. No problem.
All right. That brings us to facility policy discussion.
Yeah.
There's no committees. Well, I'm sorry. Did you meet Perkman?
Yes, Perkman met today, and we are in the process of evaluating the math program, which means we are figuring out what kind of data we want to look at to see how our math endeavors are making improvements or not making improvements and what our trends are.
Is this feedback given by the PERC committee, or are teachers allowed to give feedback in that as well?
I did ask, and the teachers are going to give feedback to the PERC committee. They're developing a questionnaire to give out to grade levels.
And parents?
Parents. I'm certainly open to accepting emails and relaying those messages. Yeah.
Questionnaire, like survey? There should be a survey. So it could
I think Mr. Thompson, Mrs. Levesque, and Mrs. Doucette are working on it for GMS. The high school math teachers have already completed a evaluation form template thing.
Mm-hmm. Good. All right. So that will bring us to the facility use policy.
We, with the nonprofit groups like the Boy Scouts, we feel that we need to be a little bit more clear in when we're charging and when we're not going to charge specifically. Historically, there's been a lot of programs that have run evenings, and there still are, and weekends, where there is no custodian present and or where there is nobody that represents the school present during the events going on. So we've had several requests for facilities use on weekends where there would be no custodians and people would clean up after themselves. I know historically in Litchfield that practice has been allowed, and even today there are some examples of that. So what we believe we need to do is to take a look at the facilities use policy that you have in place and be a little bit more clear about exactly what our expectations are for nonprofits. And there's always the catch-all phrase that you can appeal to the superintendent for a waiver of the fee. And the problem with that one is once you waive fee for one group, you almost have to waive the fee for every group. So I'm just looking for some direction from the board. Michelle put together some changes in our current policy based on a couple of other districts and what they're doing. We don't bring this to you as a finished policy. We bring this more to you to have a discussion about what do you want for a policy regarding use of facilities. And we also put different categories of uses, nonprofit and then profit, and the schools and the town come first. So if you could look through the policy and provide us with some feedback at our next board meeting, we might have a really good discussion about this. And if you'd like, we certainly could invite some of the nonprofits that use the facilities to give you some input from their perspective. So that's really why we put it on here for you.
There's not much has changed, though, in here, correct?
No, there's not a tremendous amount of changes, no.
Can you give an example? Sorry, I was going to say, can you give an example of a nonprofit that's using it now, just so when we think about it, we...
Well, for instance, the Boy Scouts right now have requests to use the facilities. I believe there's three different dates that they're going to be using it. The 29th of January, they used it, and they're looking for, I believe it's April 8th. And they want to use the gym and the cafeteria on April 8th, and that's a nonprofit organization that would be using it. And they want to, they've had the Pinewood, is it Pinewood Derby? Is that what they call it? Pinewood Derby. And that has been something that has occurred here in Jaffrey historically previously. And we're being assured that 50% of the kids are from Jaffrey that would participate in that, Litchfield. Because your current policy says that if it's less than 50%.
Litchfield.
Litchfield.
If they're from Jaffrey, fine.
Yeah. Well, they're going up to another district north west of here. And my apologies. We've been assured that 50% of the kids that are using engaged in the Pinewood activities are from Litchfield. However, you know, it's I don't know. I mean, my understanding is it does involve a variety of other communities and things like that. That's one example. Other examples are the recreation department and the basketball leagues use the facilities, and they're not using it always when there are custodians present. And to be candid with you, we also have programs going on Saturday mornings, and I believe we're going to have those programs because they're sponsored by a teacher for our children, so we're going to actually pay for the custodian for that particular event. So we're a little bit sloppy being all over the place, and I'd just like to have a little more conversation about this if you want, or if you just want to leave it up to the superintendent's discretion, that's fine too, but I didn't want to have a public conversation.
Well, do we require a custodian to be on site?
We would like, in those cases, to have a custodian on site. There's a couple of reasons. One of the reasons is at least it would give us an employee on site for any liability issues. And secondly, the employee on site, the custodian on site, can open up the building, and the custodian can close the building, and the custodian can make sure that the building is left in proper condition. Not that I'm saying that most of the time the people from the community are excellent, but if we don't have a custodian there, then it used to be, from what I understand before I was here, but there used to be the situation where an employee, a custodian or something would come over in the morning, open it up, leave, and then come back later on in the day and close it up. But that is not occurring right now. And so if we want to have someone come over in the morning and open it up, we're pretty much looking at overtime, or looking at some kind of custodial services, and I believe that's what the problem is. And certainly, Frank, if you want to jump in on this and any other explanations.
No. I mean, it's all of that and then some. You know, we don't budget for these because they're unknown about weekends, but there's certainly, I'll give you the business side of it, not the other stuff. You have liability issues. You've got issues with use of the building, and you know, something as simple as a water faucet being left on, the sink or a toilet running. You know, if that occurs on a Saturday and we come in Monday morning because there wasn't a custodian on duty. Kitchen is a whole other issue on liability. If they're using the kitchen, you must have a food service worker who knows about gas shut off, electricity shut off. So it's from a business perspective, it's a huge liability when you're allowing your building to be opened up and used by folks that aren't aware of some of those things that may need to be addressed prior to the start of school on Monday morning.
So what happens right now, like when the Boy Scouts want to come in? Who lets them in? Or who let them in?
I don't know. I wasn't.
Well, to be honest with you, I think we probably have a custodian. I mean,
in the past or now?
Now.
Like on the 29th, who let them in?
Oh, we had a custodian.
Custodian was here on the 29th.
And they were, he was there the whole day.
Yeah. Now, in the past, again, my understanding is we used to have folks who lived in Jaffrey who worked in the district.
Litchfield.
Oh, I'm stuck on that.
You're up there, huh?
My apologies. We used to have folks who lived in Litchfield.
I just asked
it's a lot of overtime.
I'll tell you.
That's embarrassing. But and they would just come over and just do that and not look at any kind of compensation.
So on the 29th, did that cost us overtime then for a custodian for the entire day?
Yeah.
So in turn, we should be charged whatever organization that's doing it, correct?
Well, that's a question about if you have a nonprofit organization. Are we expecting a nonprofit organization to pay or not? And I think historically, you have not charged nonprofit organizations to pay when Litchfield events are going on here in the district.
Yeah, we can't. We're going to charge the rec team every time there's a basketball game. This basketball game's all weekend, I'm assuming.
Yeah. Now, there's a category the public schools have your first divvy on everything. And then, you know, the rec department and the town.
Yeah.
Is second, but it still brings up the question, I think, of are you going to have, who's going to open it up, who's going to close it, and who's going to be responsible for checking things? So you still have that whole question that's going on, and we certainly can live with whatever policy that you decide you want, but we would just like to be consistent when we talk to people.
Assuming we could get past the liability thing and have someone here that's certified to be liable, whether it's an employee or a member of the rec or something.
Well, that's how they do it, rec.
Someone's responsible.
Yeah.
Could we just change our schedule so that rather than cleaning Monday through Friday, we're cleaning Sunday through Thursday?
Well, that's what I was going to ask. I mean, at least Saturday. I mean, you think you could take whatever Friday cleaning is done?
There's no reason to clean Friday night, clean Sunday before school starts. Mm-hmm. That's what we do at my work. Like, cleaners don't come Friday night. They come Sunday night. Because in case we're in over the weekend, like...
Right. I mean, certainly.
You would think at least Saturday you could cover it by just taking Fridays and moving to Saturday.
Clean Saturday morning.
Not that easy. We've tried.
I, no,
It's not that easy. You maybe look, it's a change of work conditions.
Give you another example.
It's not that easy.
We recently had a group of kids that were preparing.
Yeah.
I just said you're cleaning around people who are using the facility.
Right.
Not if we till Sunday night, before the kids come in Monday.
Right.
But then you still have to have somebody here.
I'm saying, assuming we can get around that.
Oh, I see.
It's like rec, we don't have a custodian here for rec games. Is the rec, some of the rec department is the point of person.
But then you get a hole on Friday nights when we have events in the schools.
Yeah.
There's nobody here.
It's a difficult workaround, the liability issue too, because if you go to Primex, they want to know who was in charge of the facility, who on our payroll. If someone were to be injured in the building on a Saturday when the rec is here, their first question would be, who was responsible for the building?
Right, but each of these organizations to come in have an insurance binder on record.
They do.
Anybody who comes in, they have to have an insurance binder. That's a done deal.
That's on the liability piece. And if they do damage to the building, if something happens to the building, gas wasn't shut off properly, we had some damage.
Right.
I mean, again, I'm giving you the business approach, I get it. And I don't mean to be, but there's a lot of issues that when there's not somebody here in the building.
Right.
I think it's really a challenge, because you look at your buildings as community structures that you want the community to have access to and be able to use 24/7. But at the same time, you look at the insurance and the liability and those issues, and that's the fine line that I think we have to look at drawing.
Yep.
And the policy was not very clear on, do we charge some of these nonprofits the custodial fees and the kitchen fees?
And that's how it's broken down now, like the ABC.
Now, so we did that, but I mean, I may have missed something. I would like the board to weigh in on that.
So if everybody can, like, if you haven't had an opportunity to look through it, just go ahead and look through it, and we'll put it on for our next meeting.
Right.
Have a further discussion.
For the town of Litchfield, this is right.
The town of Litchfield, yeah.
Or Jaffrey.
We can look at Jaffrey's too, if you'd like. Interchangeable.
We're friendly.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
That's okay. All right, any questions on the manifest?
I had a quick one. Scott Sprawlin, he came in and gave us a prep on the social media thing, kicked off that whole Twitter.
Yeah.
Great. He's still charging us monthly.
Who's that?
Scott Sprawlin, the Sprawlin Group.
We terminated that contract with Scott effective the end of January.
Okay, I just noticed there was still the charge there, so I wasn't sure. Okay. Cool.
All right. Public input.
Okay.
We're in for non-public over 21.
A few things.
Yeah, that's right.
Public input over 21.
That's right. Nate Cooper, social studies teacher at Campbell High School and president of the Litchfield Education Association. I just wanted to take a minute to thank everyone up here for their work today and every time you meet, and just an opportunity to speak directly to community members, just to remind them that voting day is on March 14th, and I hope that we'll have a really good turnout by everybody in the community. I'd certainly encourage anyone interested in learning about any of the articles, whether it be the budget, the contracts, or any of the other important issues that you have all discussed here and at the deliberative session and elsewhere, to visit social media. There's a lot of great information out there on the Facebook pages of the school board, certainly the Litchfield Education Association, and even the candidates running for office. So we hope people will go ahead and take an opportunity to educate themselves, ask questions, and we hope we see a really good turnout on March 14th. So I think it's important, no matter what your views are, your position might be, that you go ahead and take the opportunity to voice that on Tuesday, March 14th. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. That will bring us to non-public, RSA 91-A:311. The dismissal, promotion, or compensation of any public employee or disciplining of such employee for the investigation of any charges against him, unless the employee affected, one, has a right to a meeting, and two, requests that the meeting be open, in which case the request shall be granted. The hiring of any person as a public employee, matters which, if discussed in public, would likely affect adversely the reputation of any person other than a member of the body of the agency itself, unless such person requests an open meeting.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. And now we're non-public.